God, we just thank you for today. I just pray that you will just move through us, God, as we sing, and that you will just move through everyone in their individual living rooms, God, that you will just let your Holy Spirit fall wherever people are. We just thank you for today. Please bless it.
Our God is the author, the first and the last. And his works, they resound through the generations past. From creation to Savior to the world we now see. Our God is sovereign in the power he keeps. Our God is a healer who will never change. Defender of the weak and a shield for the same. And he binds up the broken and raises the dead. Well, if our God is for us, then who can be against? God will forever and ever be praised. 1 million days our lips sing his praise. And when we have finished, start it again. For our love will go on.
Amen.
So praise him, oh praise him, let all the saints rise. Claim the redemption for which he's crucified. Chimes of freedom, eternal will reign. For he reigns supreme, our God and our King.
We love you, Jesus. We love you, God. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Hey guys, thank you so much for joining us today at church. You guys having an awesome day? Hey, why don't you turn to your neighbor, say glad to see you, give him a hug, and let him know you're super excited to see him at church. Man, I miss seeing you guys. Like in real life, I miss seeing everybody. I miss church, but hey, I'm also super excited that I still get to hang out with you guys, that we still get to have church. I'm Pastor Jason McCutcheon, executive pastor here. I've been also, obviously, I'm doing some worship too. But today, we are having church, and we couldn't be more excited about it. So we got a couple announcements for you guys. After service, we want you guys to join us. We got a meet and greet with the pastor. All you got to do is click on the Zoom room, head on in there, and there's going to be some people. And we just want to, if you're new around here, we want to get to know you. One of the cool things about having online church is we have all kinds of people checking us out and visitors, and we want to give you an opportunity to get plugged in, meet the pastor. So go ahead, click on that link. It's a Zoom room. It's immediately following service. Anybody's welcome. Check it out. BCC Kids is still going on, even though we're not meeting together. We're still having church at home in a bunch of different ways, and one of them is through BCC Kids. Pastor Brandy has an incredible program on YouTube. If you're looking for something to do with your family and ways that you can pastor your family, some fun stuff for kids to do that's centered around Jesus, check out what we got going on with BCC Kids at home. You know, on that note, Pastor is going to be doing something that I think I'm super encouraged by and super excited by with my own family, which is a thing called church at home. And we're going to be talking all about what it looks like to bring the church into our homes. And it's not just about being quarantined, and it's not just about sheltering in place. This is like a future for the rest of our lives things. How do we bring spiritual disciplines into our families with small kids all the way into teenagers? And so we're super excited. Pastor and Sherry are going to be doing this class next 4 weeks. It's going to be at 8 o'clock every Wednesday night. I'm going to say it again, 8 o'clock every Wednesday night. It's going to be a Zoom chat, and we're going to be posting links everywhere. So if that sounds interesting to you and you have a family, definitely check it out. Next Steps class is still going on. So if you haven't had an opportunity, maybe you serve on Sundays, this is going to be perfect for you guys, because we got Next Steps online every single Monday night for the next 4 weeks. Definitely sign up. It's going to be 8 p.m. Monday nights, Next Steps Online. We really want all of you guys to be attending this, who are really making a commitment and making a decision to make this your home church. Or if you're a leader and you just haven't had an opportunity to go to the class, definitely take this opportunity to go to this class. We said it every week, and I'll say it again. There has been just such an outpouring of generosity, and we are so grateful, and I would say humbled as pastors, to have a church that's so supportive in the middle of this crazy time. And so we just thank you from the bottom of our hearts. And so we're going to continue to be a church that gives and continue to be a church that supports the work God is doing on this earth. And really, if you haven't been to our church, we believe giving is a form of worship. We do it because we love the Lord. And so if you want to serve in that way, you want to worship in that way, then we invite you to take part. There's a bunch of ways we give you to give through the app, or there's a link in the chat, all these different ways. If you're not comfortable, if this isn't your home church, if you don't want to give, there's zero pressure. Don't feel pressure at all, because we just want to serve you. We're just giving this service to you as a gift. But those of you that want to take part in worship, feel free. We want to give you that opportunity as well. So I just want to pray for us today, and then we're going to continue on in our worship service. Dear Lord, thank you so much for what you do. Thank you that we have anything to give. In this time, God, where money is seeming like it's a big stress for a lot of people, those of us that still have something to give, we are so grateful that we still are able to. God, you own the cattle on 1,000 hilltops, and so I just want to pray a blessing upon families right now, and pray upon their finances, God, that you would watch over them, and that you would be gracious to them, that you would look out for them. And so we lift up your name today, and we want to bless it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You. children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and their family, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before.
Grateful that our homes can become an altar to you. That our families can become a church, God. That our hearts can be your home, God. Let's sing, amen. And thanks for letting us in your home today, in your residence. We are so honored that you would do that and you would take the time to join us for worship. And we appreciate all of our guests and all of our first-timers or people who've just gotten to know us since we've been live streaming. Thank you so much. We're so pleased and we're so grateful that you've let us in your home today. I so appreciate our worship team, our technical team. In fact, I just got a letter today that I want to read to you. It's from Gene Morphus, who's a member of our church. He said, Pastor Phil, please tell your entire team congratulations and thanks from Pam and me. I know enough about live streaming and inserting graphics to understand that effort was not trivial. Best, Gene Morphus. So Gene's been in the corporate world for many years, and so he knows something about what it takes. So I want to say thanks to my guys and gals who've been doing this every week and making sure that you can worship, we can worship together as a church. We've really discovered, haven't we, that the church is not a building, but it's the people of God. And I'm so grateful that you have been such an amazing congregation and you've made this one of the greatest times that we'll always remember. A couple things I'll word today.
I want to tell you about First Steps. First Steps is for those of you that are exploring life, faith, and purpose in Christ. You've just made the decision to follow Christ, or you want to just check it out. We've got four special videos on Christ, the church, the Bible, and the Holy Spirit. So I hope you'll avail yourself of those. Click that link on the screen. And after you finish watching them, if you want more information that will help you in your faith journey, please let us know. I also would like to give you the opportunity to learn more about our church today and more about the ministry. I'll be available after the service in a special Zoom room, and you can meet with me. And I'd love to, if you're new or you're a recent check in with us during this live stream, I'd love to meet with you and get to know you and tell you more about our church. So please avail yourself of that. We've heard some incredible counsel and wisdom about how to manage crises in the last 6 weeks, haven't we? We've heard about courage, we've heard about faith, we've heard about perseverance, and we've heard about loving one another. All great advice. I wouldn't change a thing that we have said here, and so much that I've heard from other sources. There's been a lot of content, a lot of pastors, a lot of leaders, both inside the church and outside the church, have given us some great counsel. Well, I want to share some counsel today that you probably haven't heard. Now, it's not just related to the coronavirus. In fact, from what I can see and from what I can hear, I have a lot of optimism that we're going to get back to our normal lives, not too distant future. But what I'm going to share today, I believe, has more to do with the rest of your life and the life as it will be, hopefully in a few days or a few weeks, when everybody's back in our jobs and we're going to restaurants and we're enjoying that life that we have kind of laid aside for a while. I was directed to this thought by an article by N.T. Wright. And here's the article. I'm not going to read the article to you, but here's a quote from the article. The title of the article, it's a very provocative title. It says, "Christianity offers no answers about the coronavirus." Kind of an interesting title. In the article, he says, "Rationalists want explanations, romantics want to be given a sigh of relief, but perhaps what we need more than either is to recover the biblical tradition of lament. Lament is what happens when we ask God why and don't get an answer." So I want to talk to you today. The title of my message today is The Loss of Lament. Reclaiming the power of holy grief. The Bible says we sorrow as not as those who have no hope. So we're not just talking about sorrow. We're talking about something that will release the power of God in your life in a new way. In the Bible, lament was a tool that God's people used to navigate pain and suffering in their lives. In the Bible, lament meant to express sorrow, mourning, or regret in prayer. It's a form of prayer. You know, one-third of all psalms were laments. It's a tool that's been left in the bottom of a lot of our spiritual toolboxes. It's a tool, especially in this 21st century, we deal with our problems using positivity, self-reliance, using our rationality. We deal with our problems using rage. And you know, all of those tools are effective. We need to have positivity. And you probably, at your work, you probably have posters with motivational sayings as you go down the halls of your company, right? Thank God for those, that whatever the mind can conceive, man can achieve, and those kinds of statements that motivate us. And rationalization is important, that we be able to find answers. It's a scientific approach to our problems. But unfortunately, it's kind of what Job's friends did. When Job's friends came to see him for 7 days, they lamented with him, and then they became research scientists. And they began to feel like we have to have answers. And especially in the church, especially as Christians, we feel like we've got to have answers. We've got to be able to say why. We say things like, God sent the coronavirus so he could teach us to love one another, so he could teach us to appreciate one another, so he could teach us to care about one another. Now, first of all, you don't know that God sent this plague on the world. Because we want answers so bad, and the human brain doesn't like a void. We don't like not having answers, so we try to rationalize things and figure things out. And of course there's self-reliance. We've been taught to pull ourselves up our own bootstraps, We've been taught to use grit to get through the problems of life and the difficulties of life. But what about the one tool that we find in Scripture that the Bible also includes for getting through the problems of life, the difficulties of life? You know, I'm grateful for my parents. I'm grateful that they understood the power of holy grieving, of pouring out our heart to God, their heart to God. I remember my brother was 17 years old, going the total wrong way, a lot of alcohol, a lot of rebellion. His goal was, after I graduate from high school, I'm going to move to California. And those times were very different times now. It was kind of where, back in our home in Texas, that's kind of where you went. If you wanted to get into a lifestyle that was different than a small Texas town, you went to California. Just to put it in context, one of the people that my brother rode the school bus with was a person that the world came to know later as Tex Watson. And he rode the school bus down the road in our little Texas town. And Tex Watson went to California, and he's still in prison today from the murder of Sharon Tate. That happened many years ago, but that's the times we were in. And my brother's life wouldn't be working with the homeless in Atlanta, Georgia today if he had gone to California, I don't think. But I remember, you know, during this time when my brother's life was so rebellious, I remember coming home from school in our little house on Hamilton Street in McKinney, Texas. I remember coming home from school and finding my mother on the floor crying out to God, weeping over what was going on in my brother's life. And I'll never forget that day when his 55 Ford was in the driveway and the transmission was all over the driveway, and my mother went to my brother in tears and said, Joe, would you go to church tonight? Joe went to church that night, sat on the back row, but the end of that service, he gave his life to Christ. And the whole direction of his life changed. I remember the next day getting up, and I couldn't believe my eyes. This person who had been so rebellious, so rude, so unkind to everybody, this person who had been going a totally different direction, puts his Bible on top of his books and goes to school in his senior year of high school. That illustration embedded into me in a way that I can never forget the power of lament. I'm grateful for that. It's strange that we would abandon weeping before God and lament, because it is so much in the Bible. Biblical prophets would sit in sackcloth and ashes to lament the state of the world around them and the state of their nation. Probably the most famous book in the last 25 years is the Prayer of Jabez. Prayer of Jabez, probably the most popular book in recent times. What's that story about, those of you who've read that book? That story is about someone who cried out in pain, and God answered them. And, of course, someone would say to me, well, all that's Old Testament. But the New Testament, Acts chapter 8, verse 2, says some devout men buried Stephen and made loud lamentations over him. That's in the New Testament. So, see, some people, one thing that happens to Christians is we often think, well, Jesus went to the cross and Jesus was resurrected from the dead. We're not going to have any problems anymore. We're not going to have sorrow. But the entire Christian religion is built on the foundation of a Jesus who lamented. You could say that the entire Christian religion is built on the foundation of a lamenting Lord. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7. It says, while Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who would rescue him from death, and God heard his prayers because of his deep reverence for God. Jesus was neither a superhero or a wizard. He was moved with compassion. Jesus' secret sauce was that he wept over people, that he had deep feelings. Lament was his secret sauce. He could heal the blinded eyes because he wept over blind people. He could raise the dead because he wept over grieving families. He could deliver those in bondage and those addicted and those under demonic powers. He could deliver them because he wept over people who were in bondage. He could save the nation of Israel because he wept over Israel, literally. He could save the world because he wept over the world. Perhaps, I've been running prayer meetings for about 40 years, and I've got to be honest, I haven't seen very many tears. I haven't seen very many times when people really came together and really sorrowed over the things that they needed God to change. In the biblical times, they had something called stoicism. Stoicism is the endurance of pain without the display of feeling and without complaint. It came from an ancient Greek school of thought that rose up in Athens during Jesus' time. And it was during that time that they taught that the highest virtue was to live in harmony with divine reason and be indifferent to pleasure or pain. In other words, have no emotion. Have no emotion about what's going on around you. Some people think that's faith. They think that's faith, to have no sadness, no sorrow, no normal emotion about what is going around you. But let me tell you something. When Christ comes into your life, when he fills you with his spirit, he makes you a better human. He makes you a healthier human. He makes you a person who can relate to the people around you. You can't relate to somebody who has no sorrow. You can't relate to somebody who doesn't feel pain. Let me give you some advice today from Psalms chapter 13. Hopefully you're one of those people who, when the preacher preaches, you like to get your Bible out and you like to just park your eyes on the text he's going to read from. So I'm going to go to Psalms chapter 13. And this is, Psalms chapter 13 is a prayer that teaches us how to lament, how to do righteous grieving. Psalms 13 and a whole bunch of other passages in the Psalms teach us three things. It teaches us to grieve, to plead, and to believe. To plead and believe. Grieve. Let's read verse 1 and 2. How long, O Lord, will you forget me? Forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart daily? How long will my enemy be exalted over me? Now, in this passage, David asked four times, how long? Now, that's a man who's frustrated, would you say? That's a man who's had it. That is a man who is emotionally exhausted. That's a man that feels worn down. Perhaps you today are feeling worn down. What are you feeling worn down by? Children who, like my brother, are turning away from faith, going down a path, and you're worried about them? A culture that mocks your faith and family values? A purpose and meaning in life that's just eluding you? You know, this past week, Chris Cuomo at CNN said this: I don't like what I do professionally. He said, I don't think it's worth my time. I don't think I'm mean enough. I don't think I matter enough. I don't think I can really change any things. So what am I really doing? Ever think that the starting point for real change? I would say to Chris Cuomo, I would say, Chris, ever think that that's the starting point of real change? If you would just move that cry to God, I will promise you, if he will move that cry to God, that's a lament. What Chris Como gave us was a lament. If Chris Como will move that lament to God, he will get revelation from God about what he is to do with his life. That's how God has wired us. God has wired us to grieve over things that grieve him. God has wired us to grieve over things that are not as he intended them to be. I hope you can hear me today. We're missing the therapeutic benefits of holy lament. We're missing the therapeutic benefits of grieving. Grieving and lament reconnects the brain and the heart. I said it reconnects the brain and the heart. We think and we feel. God wants to put those two together. And when we bring our heart and our mind into his presence, our soul and our spirit into his presence, then we begin to flourish as human beings. We're also missing the soul-cleansing detox, I would call it, of lament. The soul-cleansing detox of lament. When you habitually refuse to lament over that which is lamentable, there develops this disconnect, as I talked about a second ago, between your heart and your brain, that makes you incapable of a whole range of healthy human habits, including empathy for others and sensitivity to normal social graces. That's why a child, if you have a child and you constantly protect them from being unhappy, you will have a child who will grow up in it with the inability to love other people. The inability, you will have a child that will grow up socially dwarfed and socially malformed if you have a child that you're determined that they're never to be happy. Or if you never discipline them to the point of tears, and I'm not suggesting abusing a child at all, please. But if you never meet out a discipline that they will cry over, then you will not have a child that grows up healthy and really able to live their lives in a way that with love and care and responding to other people and even doing proper self-care. You see, God has designed us to need a certain amount of grief. Not all the time, of course, but once in a while. You know what the most important thing, if you skip sadness and you say, I'm not going to have any sadness in my life, I'm never going to be sad, the most important thing you're missing is the theological principle that God is God and we are not. See, if your only tools for getting through life are positivity, I'm just going to be positive about this, or rationalization, I'm going to always find the answers, I'm going to find the scientific solution to everything I'm going through, or self-reliance, I'm always going to use grit to get through, or I'm going to always use rage. You know, people are using rage to the extreme today. I don't know if any of the rest of you are on Twitter like I am, but I'll tell you, there's some rageaholics out there. They're using rage. It's like you've heard the saying, a carpenter tends to see every problem, see every problem as a nail that needs a hammer. That's what happens when people want to use rage. If I just rage against things, then they will get better. No, those tools all have their place. But the tool that I'm talking about today, and the one that I feel like we've abandoned in the culture today, is the tool of simply crying out to God. Simply turning to lament and saying, God, like the ancient Jehoshaphat, there was an ancient king named Jehoshaphat who was surrounded by the armies of Amalekites who came against Israel. He was outnumbered 100-1. Now, all those other tools I mentioned, he could have made all the positive assertions that he wanted to. He could have raged at the situation. He could have taken all his generals into a room and tried to rationally figure out how can we defeat the Amalekites. But none of that was going to work that day. But you know what Jehoshaphat did? Jehoshaphat prayed this prayer. He said, we don't know what to do. but our eyes are upon you. I don't know what to do, Lord. That's a lament. I don't know what to do, but my eyes are upon you. And you know what happened? God gave him a creative solution. He did the most irrational thing that a person could ever do. Instead of sending his army out there to face the Amalekites, he sent his worship team. He sent the choir. And the choir went out in front of the army singing, "The mercy of the Lord endureth forever." You see, when you start going to God without answers, when you start going to God just being emotionally honest, then God can begin to give you creative solutions that you would have never thought of before. Somebody watching me right now, you're at home and you're really, really, really concerned about the direction your teenagers are going. You're really concerned about the direction that they're going, and you've tried all those other tools that I mentioned. You've certainly tried rage. You've certainly used the tool of rage. How many of you out there have used the tool of rage with your teenagers? But you've never tried grieving in the presence of God. You've never tried what my mother did. You've never tried going into the bedroom, closing the door, lying down or sitting up. I don't care your bodily posture. But say, "God, we don't know what to do. My wife and I, my husband and I, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you." I'm telling you, there's a power available to you and the power available to every human being watching this today, a power available to you that if you will humble yourself before God and practice holy grieving about that which you don't know what to do anything about, God is waiting on us to give him a chance to be God. That's what I mean. When we refuse to lament, one of the greatest tragedies is we don't allow ourselves to admit that we're not God, but he is. Because all those other tools I mentioned are things that I do under my own power. So grieve, though, must lead to plead. Psalms chapter 13, verse 3 and 4, "Consider and hear me, O Lord, my God, and light my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. Lest my enemies say I have prevailed against him. Lest those who trouble me rejoice when I am moved." Now, many of us in the faith community know about some language that some of you out there who were raised in more traditional churches and you did high church, you won't be familiar with this language. But we use language like binding, loosing, and claiming. These are the tools. These are the favorite tools of where I came from as a child in the body of Christ, was binding, loosing, and claiming. We would actually say things like, "We bind you, Satan, in the name of Jesus." We claim our healing. We loose the power of God in this place. You know, I still pray like that sometimes. I believe that there is authority in being a believer, but they're not silver bullets. They're just part of the tools in the toolbox. Listen, there are times in your life when taking authority is exactly what you need to do. But there will be times in your life, like in the book of Psalms, like in Psalm chapter 13, when all of your claiming and all of your binding and all of your loosing is not going to change the circumstances that you're in. So what do you do? When my confidence is high, sometimes I can just say, "I rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus," and man, it works. Sometimes I say, "Rebuke you in the name of Jesus," and he doesn't move. Well, the Bible knew that was, it's so abnormal for us to act like there's only one way to have a relationship with God and a relationship with life that's successful. Look at Romans 8:26. "The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what to pray for." Underline that in your Bible. We do not know what to pray for. You say, "Well, I always know what to pray for. I always know what to claim. I always know what, I know exactly what God's gonna wants to do with the coronavirus. I know," you know what? I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know how to pray about some things right now. He says, "We do not know how we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that cannot be expressed with words." David, look at David. He says, listen, hear. You know, he says, hear, hear. In other words, God, I'm done talking. I need to turn this over to you. He said, enlighten my eyes. That's not a prayer for insight, but for energy and vitality. See, David knew what was at stake. He knew it wasn't, David wasn't afraid to die. This is not what this text is about. David wasn't afraid to die. This wasn't about being afraid to die. David knew that if he died, that adversary was going to mock him, and that adversary was going to move in. Israel had had a history of being taken into slavery, a history of having their temple destroyed. And you that are watching me right now, you have some things that there's a lot at stake in you succeeding in the thing that you're worried about right now. There's a lot at stake, and you know it's not just about you. It's about your family. It's about your community. It's about your business. It's about your church. Now that leads us. See, lament is a transitional event. You must move. This is very important. So you can get stuck in grieving. You can get stuck in pleading. But this is a transitional psalm. You must move from grieve to plead to believe. Psalms 13, verse 5 and 6. But I have trusted in your mercy. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. See, we confuse lamenting with doubt. Lamenting is not doubt. In fact, lamenting and mourning are the ultimate expressions of faith. A lament, you're going to see this on the screen. I want you to see it. A lament is not doubt. Instead, it is a way of saying to It is a way to highly exalt the Creator because you are saying, God, things are not as you intended them. You're too good, too beautiful, and too creative and awesome for this to be your ultimate will. A lament is saying, God, I believe in you. Now, David would have been shocked to think that some of you believe lamenting is the opposite of faith. David, who would have been like, what are you talking about? Complaining, grieving, mourning, and lamenting. I do that because I trust God so much. Because I have such a great relationship with God, I know that he can handle my negativity. I know he can handle my expression of pain. Righteous grieving is not a sign of hopelessness. It's the bold assertion that hopelessness is unacceptable. Lament doesn't bind the miraculous power of God. It releases it. Remember Jehoshaphat? We don't know what to do. God gave him that creative formula. His grief released the miracle power of God. Lament focuses on two important ways the problem gets solved. We try to ignore the problem, and then God waits to welcome us into his throne room. That's number one. And when we get into the throne room, we find grace to help, not in our time of no need, but our time of need. God honors desperate boldness. Israel in Egypt, we see this. Nehemiah 9:9. The Bible says, God saw the anguish of your parents in Egypt. There's Hannah, the woman in the Old Testament who wept so much for a son that the priest Eli thought she was drunk. Have you been so disturbed about something in the presence of God that someone would have thought you were taking something? God honors desperate boldness. And then in the New Testament, in the ministry of Jesus, there's a guy named blind Bartimaeus who sat by the road, who cried, oh, Jesus, oh, Lord, have mercy on me. And he kept crying it. He didn't ask for justice. He asked for mercy. That was a lament. Now, today, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to emotional honesty. I want to challenge you to emotional honesty. I want to challenge you to deep humility. And I want to challenge you to complete trust. Those three things. Emotional honesty, deep humility, and complete trust. That's what it really means to bring to God your lament. If everything is in your order, everything in your life is in order, you may not need this sermon too much right now. But if there's some of you sitting in front of your TV or front of your computer screen that you know that your life right now and things in your life are not as God intended them to be. See, that's what it means to really mourn and lament before God. You're saying, God, I know that you're too good of a God. And I know that you created the world too perfect, that there's things in my life that are not as you intended them to be. God, I want you to show me how to fix it. I want to hand it to you so you can fix it. Maybe there's no way I can fix it. And that's primarily what we're talking about. We're talking about things in your life that there's nothing you can do. There's no buttons you can push. There's no words you can say. But you're going to really put something in the hands of God. And unless he gets back to you with instructions, you're going to put it in the hands of God. We used to sing an old song, take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. Sometimes that's exactly what you can do. And sometimes that's exactly what you need to do. I'm so delighted right now to introduce somebody that's going to sing a song to you, that it's going to minister to you. Jimmy Mayo IV happens to be I mentioned my brother earlier in this sermon. Well, Jimmy Mayo IV is my brother's son-in-law, my niece's husband. And he's going to share a song with you right now that I believe is going to speak to you. After he sings, I'm going to come back and I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you about that situation that is causing you and giving you an occasion to go to God and say, God, I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you. I want you to pray with me right now. I really feel the presence of the Holy Spirit just as though we're all in this room together. I feel you're in the auditorium with me right now. And I believe the power of God. See, God wants to show up in power in your life. We talk a lot about the Holy Spirit. God wants to show up in power in your life. And I want to lead you in a simple prayer right now that's going to welcome him to take the steering wheel of your life. Going to welcome him to become the Lord of your life right now. Would you join me? Heavenly Father, I bring before you this circumstance, this problem that's more than I can handle. Father, connect my emotions and my feelings with your feelings. Help me to feel the burden that you feel for my problems. Help me to feel the grief that you feel for what's not the best in my life. God, you sent your son to the cross to make things as you intended them to be. So I know how seriously you take it when things in my life are not as you intended them to be. So Father, I grieve because you grieve. I am sad today because you are sad. Because you said in your word that you will cause all things to work together for good to those who love you and are called according to your purpose. So, Father, because of that, we know that you have decided that we would have a life that is blessed, that we would have a flourishing life with our families and a flourishing life with the world around us. So, God, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we declare you are Lord. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we release it all to you in Jesus' name. God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us with the sermon today, with worship, with prayer. I hope you will join me in the, I guess we could call it the virtual hospitality guest lounge, and talk to me, and let's talk about our church and whatever you want to talk about. God bless you. Have a wonderful, victorious day.